good month. It's now the month of May, Yin Child Month. We have with us three guests, and at this time I'm going to allow them very briefly to introduce themselves.
I'm Yokan King Blue, and I'm the supervisor at the Maroko Government Early Childhood Center.
Mrs. Gwyneth Cambridge, Senior Education Officer with responsibility for early childhood education.
Rochelle Tanis, the President of the National Association of Early Childhood Educators, currently attached to the Bekwe Anglican Early Childhood Center.
Thank you very much and welcome.
Thank you.
We're going to be discussing early childhood education, care, and development. Now, we have a very interesting theme for this year's Child Month celebration. It's building a strong foundation, ensuring a brighter future. Mrs. Cambridge, perhaps we can start with you. How is this theme relevant in the context of what's happening in early childhood education in St. Vincent and the Grenadines?
Right, that's a good question to begin with. The theme was formulated based on discussion with some of the preschool supervisors who are part of the National Association for Early Childhood Educators. And we thought that if we looked at children as being that foundation on which we want to build, then we have something that we could look forward to in the future. It is particularly relevant because in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the population, really, I think maybe about 50% or even more of our population right now, are young people. And that has a lot of implications for what goes on in the future. So when we thought of building a strong foundation, ensuring a brighter future, we're thinking not only focusing on secondary and tertiary education and a university degree, but we're thinking in terms of if you start at the very base of it with early childhood education, and it's like a step in a ladder, you know, that you just put something there at the bottom, and then you're climbing that step to ensure success. So that was what underpinned what we decided to use as, you know, the theme for early childhood education. Now, in terms of the relevance, when we're thinking that the government of St. Vincent is saying that we want to have universal access to early childhood education, then this has implications for that. When we're thinking in terms of we want our primary school students to obtain or to attain rather literacy, then it has implications for that. And when we're thinking in terms of our secondary school students choosing a career path that is going to benefit St. Vincent and the Grenadines, it has implications for that. So I want to think that it transcends all aspects of education here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, because if you speak to a child, they'll say education is going to help them to get where they want to go.
And you mentioned that Child Month really is a celebration of children, and children are not just preschoolers. Children go from age zero all the way up to secondary school age. So I know that Mrs. Blow deals specifically with the preschoolers, a supervisor of a preschool. So I'm going to ask her now, just to tell us what some of your plans are for Child Month.
Well, we try to ensure that our plans enhance the holistic development of the children. So far, we had the church service. There is an open day, per se, at the Maroko Government School. And the Maroko Government School is a part of District 5. And so, at a district level, we have also planned activities which include a sport and fun day. There is also activity where the parents and the teachers get together.
If I were to say something, that's very good. Now, you know, there are about 135 preschools in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And one of the things that we're very pleased about is that we get sometimes quite a lot of the parents are very excited when they see their children becoming involved in a very many different activities that we have.
Even at that early age.
Yes. What we would hope is that the parents continue their support of their children's education in the future.
Okay, good. Let's engage Rochelle for a little bit here. In your background, you said that you've just completed your stint at the community college as an early childhood student. What do you think is the importance of being qualified in this particular area in terms of building, you know, building that strong foundation and ensuring a brighter future?
Right. Well, personally, I decided to take on the career of being an early childhood educator because I recognize the importance of that foundational stages, the early stages in the children's lives. This is the stage where we as teachers, we help to guide them and nurture them. So the things that we would impart to them, we would have to make sure that we know exactly what we're going to say to them, what activities we're going to give them to do. The children, they look up to us as role models, so we also have to have that personality and the knowledge of how to be caring. And basically, you need to know exactly how to bring forth the learning that the children need. I believe it's not just a profession that you can just go into and know exactly what to do. You need to have the qualifications, you need to have the training, because even while we may have common sense knowledge, you still, there are certain things that, say for instance, I didn't know all of the foundational stages, the philosophies within early childhood education. And during my stint at the college, those are some of the things that I learned about. I advanced myself as a professional, and I believe that that would help me to relate more to the children, to make sure that all the different levels of their development are catered for, because it is not just about their cognitive development, it's about their holistic development, their spiritual, their physical development, their socio-emotional development. You have to make sure that all these different aspects of the child is catered for within their early development. Because if you leave one area to go unenhanced, it can affect the rest of their development and affect their future as they grow.
Mrs. Cambridge, I know that as the post in the Ministry of Education's senior education officer responsible for early childhood education, you would want to emphasize the importance of the standards and perhaps compare it against the survey that I know was done the other day. Yes.
Yes. Let me say, first of all, that the Ministry of Education has 9 early childhood centers, and, you know, the Maricopa Government Early Childhood Center is one of them, as well as the Bekwe Anglican Early Childhood Center. And I'm glad that Rochelle has been able to input here, as well as, you know, Yokan, because the two of them have their part to play in ensuring that the environment maintains what we would want to be the international standards. I always sort of, you know, emphasize that we cannot operate, you know, below the international standards, particularly since we've got people coming into St. Vincent from all walks of life and wanting to partake of the type of education that we have here. The early childhood, the quality assessment survey that was done last year left us feeling a little bit off kilter, because there were some preschools that were extremely below the national standards that we would have expected. Now, the early childhood standards is going to come on stream soon. I know we've been saying that all the time, but it is going to happen sooner or later. The thing is that we cannot wait until the early childhood standards is right there before us, before we put things in place. What I would want to say is that there were certain areas that I would want to maybe bring to the fore here that the early childhood settings would have fallen down badly in. One of those areas is the program structure, the kind of teaching and learning that takes place in the early childhood centers. A lot of the preschools and the daycare centers scored very poorly on that, because what happened is that The survey revealed mainly attention being paid to just one area, and that is sometimes the teaching sort of was just based on the picture book, maybe the coloring activity, rather than the whole aspect of the hands-on, where the children, because at their age, they're really tactile learners, where you give them things to do, where they get involved with and interact with the science. Because remember, we are really building their critical thinking skills there, even from that young. They could engage in little experiments. So in terms of the science, that was, I think, about two-thirds of the preschool setting had not paid much attention to science in their program structure. And the whole aspect of art was just based basically on the coloring that was done with crayon. There were a few schools that would have used the, you know, the colors, the paint, but not many of them used it more than maybe once per week or twice per week. In terms of international standards, what they're saying is that every day the children should be doing some aspect of artistic work. And, you know, the teachers can take them out on nature walks, pick up a piece of wood, take it back to the preschool center and polish it and make something so that they are interacting with their environment. So that is an area that we have to pay a lot of attention to. And I'm hoping that in terms of in the future, that we can engage in workshops to help the teachers who are not quite clear how they can place that in their centers. Incidentally, you know, that has, you know, implications for the theme, preparing the children for a brighter future. Because if we don't have children who can analyze situations, who are critical thinkers, then we have problems.
That's true. Mm-hmm. And I would just like to reinstate what I said before. It is very important for us as practitioners that we get the sort of training, the qualifications that we need. It's not just a matter of having a certificate on paper, but it's the knowledge that you would be gaining, because as Miss Cambridge said a while ago, the areas of science and those other areas that children need to develop. A lot of the reasons why you might find teachers not getting into that area is because they might tell you they don't know how to teach science in a preschool. When you have that training, then you would have the knowledge and the skills able to relay that kind of information, make activities that are engaging for the children, because science is everywhere around us. Mm-hmm. And children are naturally curious, so the activities, you can have a simple activity where you can take the children outside, let them look for the little bugs, that's the insects that are crawling around. You can get a microscope, a little microscope, and have them look, observe, see how they are moving.
That's right.
And that is science there in itself. You can look at the rain when it falls, the puddle on the ground, and when 2 minutes after or half an hour after, that water disappears.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to the water? Those are science. It's natural curiosity. So the training that you would get, that would help you to be able to deliver these kinds of activities for the children.
Definitely.
And help to build their enthusiasm with learning.
Tell us how you think that the Maroko Government School is observing the early childhood standards.
Well, in terms of our spacing, we have the space to accommodate the number of children at the center. We ensure that the children have a healthy environment in which to work. The curriculum, as Rochelle mentioned, about the holistic development of the child. So we ensure that whatever lesson is being done in terms of the child's social development, physical development, intellectual development, creative development, emotional, and not forgetting the spiritual aspect of it, what we call the SPICES curriculum, and we sort of integrate other curriculum into it. We ensure that our teachers at the center, that they are trained and even upgrade their skills, because every day you learn something new.
Right.
And it's a process, and so we make sure that we develop the retool their effort in terms of ensuring that we lay that foundation so that the children, because we know that they are the men and women of tomorrow, and so therefore we want to make sure that they have a bright future.
Anything as we wrap up you would like to comment on as it relates to perhaps the standard child month, any advice you would like to give early childhood practitioners? That
I would like the early childhood practitioners to know that each child within their care are promised for the future. Do not write any child off. Ensure that whatever activities you plan for Child Month incorporate all aspects of the child, and not only the child, but also have their parents involved in the activities too, so that the parents will appreciate the work that you are doing in the different centers.
And final words you'd like to leave?
Yes, I would like to encourage my fellow practitioners that we continue to upgrade ourselves. We look at this profession as not, it's not a babysitting club. It's not as people have termed it in the past, where you just take care of children, people's babies. But this is the foundational stages in a child's life. They are naturally curious. Every child is unique. They have their own gifts and talents. And we need to realize that every child has something to offer, as you can say. And we take advantage of this stage in their lives where this is the stage that they are soaking up the most information. They are ready to learn. Take advantage of that time and do what is necessary to help them to develop the skills and the attitude that they have already towards learning.
And Mrs. Cambridge, because this is the month of children, the month where we celebrate them and we talk about their education and the care and the development and so on, perhaps this is a good time for you to just highlight some of the ministry's upcoming activities, what you have planned in celebration of the children.
Right. Well, on the 17th of this month, we are partnering with the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries to hold an exhibition at the National Library. There we're going to have showcase what they do in schools. It's not only about the preschools, but we will have the exhibition is incorporating both the secondary and the primary school. So we're going to be having that at the National Library. In the districts, each district has put in, as it is, a little program of activities that they have planned. Some of them, I know that VinSave has a parenting program that they're going to be having as well. Down to the Leeward, yesterday, District 9 had a program as well. I think our own Mrs. Dyer would have been a facilitator at that program. And the other districts will be having their fun day. They will be having interactive sessions where one of the things I like is that the schools come together this time to have something doing. They're going to be as well visiting the primary school because we realize that there is an important transitioning period between the primary and the preschool, so that the preschool teachers are going to be taking the preschoolers into the primary school to observe what it is like, what their schedules are like. So they could have, as it is, hands-on observation in terms of what goes on there. We're having on the 24th of this month, GECU has kindly sponsored a writing competition for the primary schools, grade 5. We've been having the grade 5 teachers sending in the participation of those who've sent in, the writing scripts, and GECU is going to be having their, giving out the trophies and the certificates for participation for all those who are engaged in it. In addition to that, We're having our march and rally on the 30th of this month. That's the last Thursday in this month, where we're inviting both the secondary and the primary and the preschoolers as well for us to march and bring Child Month more in focus. I wish to say as well that Jujubee Bookstore has offered a 10% for those persons who are going to be buying books at her bookstore. And this is good because she too has seen the importance of Child Month. And I wish to end by saying, you know, Marla, that Child Month should not only be confined to me alone. We're just bringing it more into awareness, but it should follow through right through to the end of the year. And we are partnering with the Ministry of National Mobilization and Social Development in saying that we're highlighting children as well. And don't forget that we want to break the silence on child abuse, and we want to appeal to those perpetrators to stop destroying our children's future. Because after all, every child is a promise. And when you, you know, engage in these illicit acts, it is going to, as it were, interfere with the promise that that child could have been, whatever that child could have become.
Every child a promise for a future.